Now, Miss Price, we know that you're Welsh. What part of Wales?
Well, what used to be Monmouthshire, and which is now Gwent. Yes. We are finally part of Wales.
Monmouthshire is indeed...
It's now Wales.
And we've established that you come from a musical family. Did you start taking music lessons yourself very early?
I was taught piano, but not for very long, because I hated it and wouldn't practice, so my mother and father wouldn't give me the money to continue.
When did singing come into it?
Not really until I was 14, when in the grammar school we had a music master there who heard me singing one day and tried to persuade me that I could perhaps take up a singing career.
Yes. You were only 15 when you won an open scholarship to Trinity College of Music in London.
Yes.
Who looked after you in London?
Well, I started off in a Methodist hostel for young ladies.
Yes. How was that?
It was a Methodist hostel for young ladies.
No comment, yes.
And then I had a flat.
Yes. Was your grant sufficient to take you through your studies, or did you have to do spare-time jobs?
No. The scholarship paid for tuition alone, and because I won a scholarship, the county wouldn't give me a grant. Mm. And so my parents helped out, and I also had to do jobs like Sunday church services and weddings and things.
Yes. In fact, after only 2 years at college, when you were only 17, you made your debut with the recital at the Wigmore Hall.
Yes.
You were a mezzo then, weren't you?
I was a mezzo then, although in actual fact, I sang Shepherd on the Rock, which is, although it's not written for a mezzo, curiously enough, it was written for the Leonora in Beethoven's Fidelia.
Mm-hmm.
But even so, it's not a mezzo piece.
What did that debut lead to?
Nothing very much, in actual fact, because I was too young. I was only about 17, as you've just said.
Yes.
So it didn't really produce anything.
Well, you went on to win various prizes. How did you visualise your career in your student days? Was opera your ambition, or were you thinking in terms of the concert platform?
No, again, I was really too young to know what I wanted to do. And when I left college at 19... I asked my professor, and he said, well, don't worry, my dear, you'll find your own little niche somewhere in the world. So I then went to a friend who gave me a word of advice to perhaps go to John McCarthy. So I auditioned to him, and he took me on as one of the Ambrosian singers, and I did about 18 months of session work.
Yes, recorded operas and films. And
yes,
that
that's right, we did operas for EMI and Decca and things like that, and film sessions and BBC stuff.
Now, appropriately enough, you made your operatic debut with the Welsh National Opera Company.
Yes.
What was the role?
Cherubino.
And you sang that again the following year at Covent Garden under rather exciting circumstances.
I was Teresa Berganza's understudy, and she was taken ill on Whit Monday, and they couldn't really get anybody else to sing.
Yeah.
So they had to put me on whether they wanted to or not.
How much notice did you get?
They phoned up in the morning, and I had to go on that evening.
When was it that you met the man who's to be your partner, your accompanist in so many recital tours, James Lockhart?
At Covent Garden, when I auditioned for the understudy of Teresa Berganza.
Mm-hmm.
That particular day, he was the rehearsal pianist for these auditions. And it was funny, really, when I look back on it, because I sang the most stupid aria for me, really, to have sung, which was O Don Fatale, with terrible Italian. And the second aria was Voi Che Sapete, which I'm afraid Jim and I came to grief over, because he went his way and I went mine. It was far too fast. And, I mean, we just had a quarrel about it. And then I had to go back a couple of days later to re-audition to Scholte.
The boss.
The boss, yes. And I had a different audition accompanist that day, and it was Bob Keys. So I turned round and I said to him, well, I hope you're better than the last one, because I mean, he was absolutely terrible. He didn't follow me at all. So I said, oh, don't worry, dear, I'll follow you.
Yes, and the man you quarrelled with was to become your accompanist for...
That's right. Years. We've had 12 years now of working together.
What other operatic parts did you play?
Zerlina in Don Giovanni.
That was next.
That was the next role. Then later on I sang Constanza at Glyndebourne, which again was a debatable point as to whether I should sing it, because having started off as a mezzo-soprano, I didn't really think that I had any high notes in my voice at all, and Constanza goes up to a top D.
Yes.
But with careful work and things, I found that the D was there. So mm-hmm. I had very happy memories of singing that role at Glyndebourne.
Yes, in Il Seraglio.
Yes.
And then you sang Pamina in the Magic Flute. That was at the Garden.
That was at the Garden. And then I went on to sing it at San Francisco.
Yes. It was, I think, in Cologne, in just 4 years ago, 1971, that you had a success which really made a great difference to your career.
Yes, that was singing Don Anna in Don Giovanni. Mm. I had done the previous season Così fan tutte in San Francisco and worked for the first time with Jean-Pierre Ponelle, and he persuaded me that I should sing Don Anna, and so eventually I did, and it was a very great opening mm-hmm. for me.